Hello, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Dr. Ken Berry, a family physician. And in this episode of Wednesday Live at 5, I've got a very special guest who I'm greatly honored agreed to join me. I tricked him into doing this. It's Dr. Ben Bikman, who's a PhD researcher, and he's basically made it his life's mission to investigate insulin and every rabbit hole it goes down into. You've heard me talk before about insulin and how it literally is in charge of hundreds, if not thousands, of reactions in your body. We know it as the fat storage hormone. If your insulin's high, you're more likely to store fat and it's much harder to burn fat. But insulin actually has many, many other actions in the human body and indeed in all mammals. So if you know someone who is pre-diabetic, diabetic, has fatty liver, has any chronic medical condition, text them, call them, send them a WhatsApp and say, hey, jump on either Facebook or YouTube. We're live on both. And listen to Dr. Ben Bikman because he is the godfather of insulin. And I think Dr. Bickman's here. I'm going to go ahead and add him into the stream. If you guys have questions, please type them in the comments, either on Facebook or YouTube. I can see them both from my platform. Dr. Bikman, can you hear me?
Ken, I can hear you perfectly. I hope
you
can hear me.
Brother, good to talk to you again. Thanks so much for doing this with me.
Oh, my pleasure. This is a great setup you've got. I'm just delighted to be, I'm delighted to join you today. Thanks for the invitation.
Yeah, this is a really snazzy thing. I love doing this. So I have been following your work for years, literally. I've been reading your papers and watching your YouTube videos. If you guys don't know, there's probably over 100 YouTube videos where this brilliant professor, and he's not a nutty professor, he's a brilliant professor, is talking about insulin and all the ramifications if your insulin levels are not optimized. And I'd love today to talk, doctor, about insulin, about hyperinsulinemia, about the thing that we call insulin resistance. But I really suspect that we should not call it insulin resistance. I feel like we should call it what it is, which is hyperinsulinemia. Before we get started, tell everybody, give everybody a 30-second bullet, who you are, what you do, and why we should care about what you say.
Yeah. Well, thanks, Ken. That's a good introduction. I'm Ben Bikman. My PhD is bioenergetics, which means I spent time and have ever since the early 2000s studying the use of energy in organisms. And some would then just say, well, that's the study of metabolism, and that is accurate. But the degree bioenergetics left me with an interest in further learning what dictates how the body uses energy, and that has progressively been leading me more and more towards focusing on insulin, like you say. And that's just because if you try to understand energy use in the human or human metabolism, If you remove insulin from that equation, you're just not going to find the answers.
Right. And very often, many researchers and many pundits and sycophants will try to remove insulin completely from the picture. They'll try to remove carbohydrates and insulin and say, oh, it's this or that. But really, that's like ignoring the four tires on the road and blaming it on the car's turn signal. It's kind of foolish, and I love it that you kind of bring us all back to the root cause and to the primary underlying problem, which I think is a inappropriate insulin metabolism.
Yeah, and to add to that, it's unfortunate if someone doesn't want to acknowledge the role of insulin, they're just insisting on trying to paint a picture without the full spectrum of colors. You're really just removing. Your analogy is great with the tires. You're just removing an essential piece of this overall machine, which is our understanding of human metabolism. The obsession on just the pure thermodynamics of it, that this is purely calories in, calories out, although that alone, that in and of itself is widely misunderstood. But even still, to try to view human metabolism through the lens of perfect thermodynamics is deeply faulty. We are complex machines, far more than just some closed thermodynamic system. It just doesn't work in any organism.
Yeah, and what Dr. Bickman's alluding to is the first law of thermodynamics. And both he and I, we get a lot of I call them Kiko nuts because calorie in, calorie out, Kiko. They will say, first law of thermodynamics, dummy, calories in, calories out. And my answer to that is always, the human body is not a closed system. We are an open system. The chair you're sitting in right now is having a thermogenic effect on your body. The clothes that you're wearing or not wearing, we're not judging here.
Yeah, in fact, it's this whole new Zoom world. I can, as far as everyone knows, we're pantless right now.
You can totally watch this in your boxers. It's totally fine. I don't mind, but just don't come live on screen. But every single thing, the ambient temperature in the air in my office right now, that's having a thermic effect on my metabolism. So to calculate your calorie needs and your calorie expenditure quickly becomes a calculus problem. It is not an addition or even a multiplication problem. Yeah. And it really comes down to, it is impossible to ever truly know your caloric expenditure for an hour, much less for a day or for weeks or months. You're literally picking a number at random in the dark. And so, but insulin is something that's very concrete. Fat burning, that's what I'm all about, right? It's to help you burn fat. If you want to lose weight globally, if you want to lose bone density, if you want to lose muscle mass, then calorie restrict, because you'll lose fat, but you'll also lose bone density and muscle, and you'll lose cartilage and tendon and sinew.
Yep, starvation. Starvation is a wonderful way to waste away.
Yes, but you're not going to just burn fat or lose fat. If you'd like to just lose fat and keep your muscle and keep your bone density, then you have to think about the hormone model of fat burning, and that's what Dr. Bikman's all about.
Yeah, and in fact, to me, Ken, I'm somewhat saddened by the fact that too many people won't try to tease this apart, that human obesity, which, as you alluded to at the beginning of our time together, is only one of insulin's many roles or influences in the body. Insulin does so many things. But even if we just look at it from the view of the fat cell, and then extend that out to the body, it is more than just calories, and it is more than just insulin alone. But I will say, I am unaware of any situation where a person can lose weight unless insulin is low. And in contrast, or to add to that, I am unfamiliar of any situation where a person can gain weight unless insulin is elevated. And so a lot of my first steps into the low-carb community, so stepping outside of just scientific community and going into the bigger low-carb community, was my effort to try to reconcile these two theories, but actually just indicating that not only is insulin actually changing the actual biochemical handling of fat in the body and in the fat cell, but it also changes metabolic rate. We published a study in 2018, which even then was supporting studies from 20 years ago and even 100 years ago. We have known that if you give a type 1 diabetic who is initially insulin deficient, you give them insulin, their metabolic rate will slow by about 300 calories per day. We are just finishing the work to publish our paper finding that ketones, which I don't mean to introduce yet if we don't want to, in contrast, are stimulating metabolic rate. And both of this, insulin and ketones, are having an effect directly at the fat cell, stimulating the fat cell to be more or less active.
Yeah, absolutely. And we've got 1,200 people watching right now on both platforms. If you know someone who needs to hear this information, who's overweight or pre-diabetic or diabetic, or who has fatty liver, chronic inflammation, you can share this. If you're on YouTube, you can share this. If you're on Facebook, please share this with the people that need to hear it, because this information is vital. We've established over the last, since about what, the 1960s, that the calorie in, calorie out model, eat less, move more, that doesn't work, but that has went hand in hand with our obesity epidemic. So if your friend would like to actually know how to burn, preferentially burn fat, and how to reduce inflammation in their body, this is the conversation that you need to share with them. Now, Dr. Bikman, let's talk about the term insulin resistance, and let's compare and contrast with hyperinsulinemia. Is there a useful role for the terminology of insulin resistance, or has it kind of had its day?
What a great question, and it shows some good thinking about the subject. So I define insulin resistance as two things. One, insulin isn't working the same way as normal, in the various cells of the body, and that is a particular part of the disease state. In some cells, insulin is working the same as ever. In some cells, it is not. And that, again, a combination of that ends up being particularly problematic in light of the fact that the second aspect of insulin resistance is, as you state very accurately, the hyperinsulinemia. You cannot pull those two apart. Insulin resistance is hyperinsulinemia. And that is so profound in its simplicity because it changes how we detect diseases or diagnose them, and it changes how we treat them. If we look at many diseases, especially type 2 diabetes, and I hope we got a lot of people listening that are worried about type 2 diabetes, we look at type 2 diabetes as a glucose disease, but in so doing, we detect it far later and we treat it far worse. If we look at type 2 diabetes as an insulin problem, well then, over the years, the insulin's been climbing, 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 the hyperinsulinemia of insulin resistance, but it's enough to keep the glucose in check. But this right here is so important because so commonly we say that type 2 diabetes, your beta cells aren't making enough insulin. Yeah, they're not making enough insulin because what happens is, I mean, so there's some truth in that. The glucose starts to climb and then we detect the problem. But the truth of the matter is in type 2 diabetics, they still have far more insulin than the average person. It is just not enough, so-called, to keep the glucose in check. It's because the pancreas simply can't make enough. And so in that situation of the steadily climbing glucose and insulin, the average clinician will say, well, we don't care about your insulin, so we're just going to bump it up even higher, give you insulin injections because we know it'll push down your glucose. Yeah, it'll push down the glucose, but it'll make the person fatter and sicker than they were before.
Exactly right. And the problem is, the reason this conversation is so important is that many doctors, even if you're overweight, even if you're pre-diabetic, you go to your doctor for your annual checkup and they'll check a very basic panel of lab work. And one of the tests will be a fasting insulin. And if that test is normal, and remember Dr. Bikman was saying, your insulin level could be here and, yep, and your blood sugar is still, where's my other hand? I can't find it. Your glucose is normal. And so at that point, your doctor stops looking. But the problem is that your insulin level, in order to keep your glucose normal, is sky high because you're eating too many carbohydrates. And so you literally, if your doctor knew to check a C-peptide and to check a fasting insulin, they could actually diagnose your prediabetes or your hyperinsulinemia up to a decade early, up to a decade. And I actually gave a talk about this recently at a conference. Up to 10 years, your doctor could literally be clairvoyant and look into the future and say, you, my friend, are about to develop type 2 diabetes. I can tell because your C-peptide is so high, even though your blood sugar is still normal, we've got to change your diet before you become a pre-diabetic or a type 2 diabetic.
Yeah, love it. Yeah, good for you.
Absolutely. So tell it, let's talk about hyperinsulinemia. Let's unpack that a little bit. Why is that? How do we know that is a bad thing? And how bad is it? And what are some of the disastrous consequences occur from having a chronically elevated insulin level?
Yeah, in fact, let's address one of the elephants in the room. I guess there are so many on this, a topic like this. So much of the focus on aging these days is to control a protein in the cells called mTOR.
Yes.
And that has led many to say, oh, well, dietary protein increases mTOR, so that if you want to keep mTOR down and age really well, then eat less protein. And the actual human evidence, mind you, it's epidemiological, throws cold water on that idea because we see that the people, as they age, that eat the least amount of protein have the higher mortality. So that doesn't hold up. But even still, that idea of you want to keep mTOR less activated and then you're going to age well, if that is a truly valid perspective in humans, and that remains to be seen, but if it is valid, then all the more reason to control insulin because insulin stimulates mTOR far more than amino acids do from the dietary protein. So aging is related to insulin, potentially cancers. We know that breast and prostate cancers are incredibly responsive to insulin. Indeed, if you pull a biopsy of a normal breast tissue and compare it to a biopsy from a breast tumor, the breast tumor has seven times more insulin receptors in it than the normal breast tissue. That means it is 7 times more responsive to that insulin. And what does insulin do? It tells cells to grow. And that's good. We need it. It's a natural part of human, any animal physiology, but you don't want a cancer cell to be told to grow. And of course, it's stimulating that growth. And then I'll just mention another one just because it might be unexpected. Even fertility, polycystic ovarian syndrome, something I know you're familiar with in your practice because it's so common, indeed the most common form of infertility in women. It at its core is a disease of too much insulin, where the insulin is inhibiting the conversion of sex hormones in the ovaries. So this woman's ovaries end up overproducing androgens that should have been converted in, like testosterone, that should have been converted into estrogens. That's just a basic truth of physiology, that all estrogens were once androgens, so they come from testosterone. That's how it's supposed to be. But that conversion isn't happening, so her ovaries are pumping out a lot of testosterone when they should be pumping out a lot of the estrogens. So, yeah. And again, we could keep going through almost all of the systems, like, and you mentioned almost every chronic disease has some connection to hyperinsulinemia and insulin resistance.
Yeah. And just the PCOS example, many doctors will focus exclusively on the testosterone, right? And they'll actually give the patient spironolactone and other things to try to lower their testosterone. And so literally what they're doing, the root cause is up here, the insulin, but they're trying to work down here and work on this. Yeah. And it completely ignoring the kind of the watershed cascade.
Yeah.
It's all being caused by hyperinsulinemia. It's not. And so once you fix the insulin, everything else in that cascade goes back to normal. And I've seen this many times in my practice, and we've heard it from thousands of women online on social media who said, yeah, as soon as I had lowered my carbohydrate intake, got my insulin levels back to normal, I got knocked up. I can't even tell you how many times I've heard that story.
Yeah. In fact, I love the way you said it. I like to compare most chronic diseases, imagining them as branches coming off a common trunk. And if we are continuing to try to hack at these branches with various medications, for example, if someone has PCOS, there's going to be a distinct medication for that. The same person could have diabetes. That will be a distinct medication. They could have hypertension. That'll be a distinct medication. So rather than having the patient leave the office with 3 prescriptions, the result of which will just be a lifetime of increasing the dosage, instead of change the conversation and say, actually, all of these are coming off of one common trunk. Let's just chop down the tree rather than hacking away at the branches. And at the risk of seeming opportunistic, it was seeing health and disease this way that prompted me to write the book, Why We Get Sick. If anyone's interested, it is just all about insulin resistance, what it is, how you get it, why it matters, and what to do about it.
If you'll email me link, I'll put it in the show notes immediately. I didn't have access to that before, or it'd already be there. I apologize for that.
Oh, no.
I can't tell you the thousands of people who have reached out to me who used to be on 1, 2, or 3 blood pressure medicines every single day. And every doctor, what do they want to talk about if you have high blood pressure? They want to talk about lowering your salt intake.
Oh, geez.
Yeah. Which is just the dumbest paradigm in the world. Your high blood pressure almost 100% of the time. Now, there are some secondary causes of hypertension that a good doctor should always be looking for if someone has what they think is essential hypertension. They should always rule out secondary hypertension as a cause. But once they've done that, if they check a C-peptide or a fasting insulin, it immediately becomes apparent that the hyperinsulinemia is the reason you have hypertension. And so if anybody's listening with high blood pressure and you've got access to your labs on your lab portal, log in and see if your doctor has checked a C-peptide, the letter C followed by the word peptide, or a fasting insulin. If those labs haven't been checked on you, then your doctor is still ignorant of this paradigm. And I don't mean your doctor's dumb. They just haven't shifted their way of thinking yet. And Dr. Bikman and I are working on that right now. But when your doctor, when they finally shift their paradigm and go, I see the cascade now. So insulin being chronically high leads to this, and that leads to this, and that leads to the hypertension. And that's so the fluid retention, the sodium retention, and then you have high blood pressure. It's not actually the sodium doing that. It's the insulin. Oh, once your doctor has that epiphany, your doctor's going to change how they treat hypertension for the rest of their career. So it's not only going to benefit you as their patient, it's going to benefit every one of their patients. And that's why it's so important that you share this information with everyone you know who needs it. Okay, Doc, where are we going from here? What do we need to talk about next?
Well, I love that you mentioned hypertension. I'll just say it's one thing to be eating salt. The kidneys are designed to deal with that salt. And insulin doesn't let it do it properly. And insulin's forcing the kidneys to hold on to that salt, which is holding on to water, and blood pressure just stays high. But it's also why people have such significant drops in blood pressure so quickly when they adopt dietary changes. If they look at their hypertension through the lens of insulin, then they just intuitively would say, or logically, how can I lower my insulin? All right, of the foods I eat, of the three macronutrients, of course, carbs spike insulin the most, I'm just going to start eating less. Boom. Blood pressure plummets just right lockstep with insulin coming down as well.
Absolutely. And I can tell you, Doc, early in my practice, when I was starting to recommend the ketogenic way of eating to my most morbidly obese, most metabolically ill patients, they would come back anywhere from 2 weeks to a month later, and they had a scheduled follow-up at 3 months, but they'd come back in 2 weeks and say, Doc, I don't think this diet is right for me. Every time I stand up, I get lightheaded. Or I stood up and I almost passed out. And this guy's on three blood pressure medications, right? And I'm like, yeah, no, that's actually good. That means that we can now stop one of your blood pressure medications. But so many people, so often, they become wedded to their medications. Like this is, it's a part of them, right? Like I have to have my pills. And when I say, no, that's good, that means it's time to stop one or two of your blood pressure medications. You should see their face light up. It's the most beautiful thing. They're like, oh, I didn't think of it like that. It's, I just love that so much.
I do envy you that. As a scientist, I'm sort of one step removed. You, as a physician, are right where the rubber meets the road. As a scientist, we're kind of putting fuel in the tank. And one thing I envy physicians is actually having that direct experience with a patient. Yeah. I can simply just spew out information and hope that someone can pick it up and do something with it. Well, but as a primary physician, you do something with
doctors,
it.
More doctors every day are picking up your information. And what you're doing, you get that right, that you're literally saying, yes, I know that the elephant's tail feels like a rope. And yes, I know the elephant's trunk feels like a tree. And I know the elephant's side feels like a wall. But gentlemen, what you're actually all touching is an elephant, okay? And sometimes that it's very difficult, especially for intelligent people, to allow their paradigm to be adjusted. It's very uncomfortable for them because what it basically means is they've been wrong for the last 20 years of their professional career. And you know as well as I do, many professionals don't like that. They don't want to admit it. They don't want to admit what that means that they may have done to people's health in the past. But if we're to start helping people now and to really start helping people in the future, we've got to look at every medical and nutritional recommendation with fresh eyes, with new eyes, and say, wait a minute, why do I have to eat 7 servings of whole grains a day? Now, you touched earlier on the varying degrees that the different macronutrients affect insulin. Let's talk a little more about that because that's very important for people to understand. Because you'll hear people out there say, well, if you eat too much protein, you're going to spike your insulin, or if you eat this certain amino acid. So give us the relative, kind of the relative, this does this, this does, and this does this. What, and order of magnitude, if that's applicable.
I think we can do that. So let's start with the obvious one, and that's carbohydrates. Now, lest someone accuse me of being a fear-mongering with regards to carbs, I'm not. I try to present this in as rational and diplomatic a way as possible, but nothing spikes insulin as much as carbohydrates. But, of course, carbohydrates represents an incredibly diverse class of foods where we can have something like broccoli on one end and even a minimally processed potato towards that end, frankly, with regards to insulin effect. But let's just say broccoli on one end, and then we have something like, a donut. Oh, that's not fair because that has a lot of fat too. But anyway, imagine that, like a goldfish cracker, you know, like that's like meth for kids. Yeah. The moment my kids have just a few goldfish crackers, it's like orange cheese dust all over their face. You know, they can't stop themselves. So there's a huge difference. So let's take the worst of that. you know, like a piece of bread or goldfish crackers, that's going to spike insulin roughly 10 times over normal. So if they're at around, let's say they're marginally healthy, not I would consider the best range, but they're 10 microunits. And if someone is able to look at their labs, like you mentioned, they will have that microunits, that teeny little funky M, and then units, a big L. If that's around 10, which is good, which is pretty good, not as good as it could be, but it's pretty good. It's the insulin, they can expect their insulin to be up around 50, 60. And depending on the person, it can stay elevated for up to 4 hours. If they're insulin resistant, it just amplifies that insulin response. It pushes it up higher because the body needs more of it to do one of its effects, which is pull the glucose or push the glucose out of the blood and into the tissues. Because if blood glucose stays too high for too long, it's lethal. So insulin's trying to save the day. If you're insulin resistant, it just takes longer for that to happen. But that's longer.
You said that the insulin spike can last for hours.
Oh, yeah, up to 4 hours. Absolutely. Yeah. Excellent. Yeah. Okay. That is relevant because for those 4 hours, not to change the topic, I promise I'll get back onto it. But that means the body is stuck in sugar burning mode for 4 hours, and actual fat burning is just pressed down to almost zero. So you mentioned a lot of the focus being fat burning. Insulin is control of that hybrid engine. If the body's in blood sugar burning mode, fat burning mode, insulin's what's dictating that choice. So that's 4 hours where fat burning is almost essentially dropped, and then sugar burning is through the roof, and then slowly as insulin comes down, well, then sugar burning can start to climb again. So anyway, carbohydrate has a substantial effect, so my advice is just be smart about it. Not, you don't have to eat zero, but just be smart. And then protein can have an effect where insulin can go up a few multiples, you know, two or three times when it's just consumed alone. But so much of that depends on the person's underlying glycemic status. And that was one of my talks from before, which was a whole hour-long talk, so I won't get into the details right now. But if glucose is also high, then protein, let's imagine someone eating glucose and carbohydrate and protein, which in nature does not happen very often, right? Carbohydrate and protein don't typically go together, but there are a few instances like milk, and that's a perfect food for growth. But nevertheless, if someone eats carbohydrate and protein, then that will amplify the insulin effect of the protein. And then lastly, we have fat, dietary fat alone, which also in nature does not happen often, although I can appreciate the utility of eating fat or adding fat to coffee or a drink. I can appreciate the utility, although I'm sometimes wary that it's overused. But fat alone, In normal amounts, up to like a few hundred calories even of the pure fat, has no effect on insulin based on the best evidence. But then there is a study to show that if it's higher, like 500 or so calories of fat, insulin will go up statistically significantly, but it is still very modest compared to the other macronutrients. So we'll say carbohydrates has a substantial effect. Protein will have a varying effect, but much more modest. Fat alone will have little to no effect.
Excellent. I love it. I love it. We've got 1,500 people watching now, and they all have questions. I'm trying to find a question that I can ask that'll benefit a lot of people. And so basically, if you're relatively metabolically healthy and you eat some pure fat, say a teaspoon of butter, that's going to have minimal to no effect on your insulin elevation.
Oh, I'd say no effect. That little fat, nothing.
Yeah. And so many times when I'm helping people kind of come to the keto way of eating, we talk about fat bombs. And my favorite fat bomb is just a teaspoon of grass-fed butter and put some salt on it and eat it. And so there are so many gurus out there in the ketogenic community that says if you put butter in your coffee, that broke your fast. And the fast that I'm talking about, and I think the fast that you're talking about, is a physiological fast that keeps your insulin as low normal as possible. That's how you get rid of the inflammation, and that's how you burn the stored fat, is by keeping that insulin level as low as possible. And if pure fat doesn't elevate your insulin level, then in my way of thinking, it's not breaking that physiological fast that we're talking about. Does that make sense?
Well, in fact, yes, I agree with it wholeheartedly. I use a different sort of terminology there, but it's the exact same idea. I compare caloric fasts to nutrient fasts, where but you're sort of alluding to this as well in the form of what we could also call a fat fast. I've heard Megan Ramos, who works with Jason Fung in their fasting protocol, call it that, and I think it's totally accurate. I define a fasted or a fed state based on the effect of insulin and glucagon. Insulin is the hormone of fed state or eating and storing energy. Glucagon is the hormone of fasted state and using energy, not storing it, mobilizing it to be used by the body. So if we look at the fat cell, for example, or glucose that is stored in the liver, insulin is telling the tissues to pull in glucose and fat and hold on to it. And it's also telling the liver to make fat from any glucose, from any excess glucose as well, and store that or send it out to be stored in the fat tissue. In contrast, glucagon is breaking down that stored glucose, that stored fat, to be used by the body. So if we look at fasting or feeding in the context of insulin and glucagon, a fasted state has very low insulin, very high glucagon. A fed state has high insulin, low glucagon. And we can measure this ratio based on just looking at insulin and glucagon. And importantly, if someone is adhering to a ketogenic diet, which of course, as everyone knows, is a very low carb diet, their insulin to glucagon ratio or insulin to glucagon levels are much closer to a true fasted state when you're not eating anything than it is to a typical fed state when the feeding is based on the standard American diet, high fat, high carb. So that is one of the other reasons I am an advocate of a low carb diet, because it continues to provide the benefits of fasting while acknowledging that a fast always has to end. You can't fast indefinitely. Right. So don't break your fast, really. I mean, you put something back in your guts, but you're still keeping the body in that state of energy use and energy mobilization.
Yes, exactly right. And so for those of you who are watching who are complete and utter newbies to the low carb or the keto or the carnivore way of eating, physiologically, medically speaking, there are essential fatty acids that you have to get from fats. If you don't get them, you will get sick, you will suffer, and you will eventually die if you don't get them for a long enough period of time. There are essential amino acids that are that come from proteins. If you don't get these essential amino acids, you will get sick, you will suffer, and you'll eventually die if you don't get them in your diet. But there is no essential sugar. There is no essential starch. There is no essential carbohydrate, to my knowledge. The doctor may disagree with that. But you just don't ever need, essentially, to eat a carbohydrate. And so that a ketogenic way of eating, in my way of thinking, is a fasting mimicking diet. If you're doing it at a low enough carbohydrate intake level, it mimics fasting. All of the benefits of fasting, including the autophagy, including the reduction in inflammation, and including the increase in fat burning, you get all of that with a ketogenic way of eating without just fasting.
Yep. Well said. I agree wholeheartedly. My addition to that sentiment, which is awesome, is that when it comes to carbohydrates, neither you nor I are saying they're wicked, avoid them at all costs. It's there are things within that family of carbohydrates that I think can be useful, especially in the context of the standard American diet or the simple reality of the world we live in with all of these hyper-palatable processed foods. And so fiber can help in this typical, I believe, in a typical diet. If you can focus more, if someone's going to be eating carbs, well, then try to focus on carbs that are sources of fiber, yeah, along with the nutrients. And in this, the polyphenols or the other metabolites in some plants, I believe the evidence suggests it can be helpful. But I think that is particularly relevant in the context of standard American diet.
Yeah. And I tell people all the time, if you're eating a high carbohydrate diet, please get more fiber in your diet.
Yeah.
Because you want to move that toxic crap through your GI system and through your colon as quickly as you possibly can. The lower carbohydrate diet that you eat, I think fiber becomes less and less important. And you and I both, Ben, know many carnivores who don't eat any fiber at all for years at a time. And everything works great, including pooping. That works great too. And so I think that it depends on your carbohydrate intake as to how important fiber is. Now, that's a very valid point. I'm glad you brought that up. So tell us about this book. I've been hearing about this for a while, and I've been itching to get my hands on a copy.
Well, I'll get you one the moment they come out. I can't wait to get my hands on a copy either. Yeah, so about 4 years ago, maybe even 5 years ago at this point, I gave a series of lectures here at BYU at my university, and this was just to the public. Every summer, BYU has sort of opens the campus where they invite faculty and others to just do a week-long series or seminar about their area of expertise. And I focused on, it was called Why We Get Sick. And it really emphasized, it was built on these ideas we're talking about now, the relevance of insulin resistance in chronic disease. So I do this series, and it's by the end of the week, it's standing room only, very positive response, which surprised me more than anyone else. And so many people just asked, what is your book? Where can we get your book? And I thought, Ben, you've missed an opportunity here. I could have been spreading the message and supplementing a modest professor's salary, perhaps. That was the beginning.
Your brain cubic inches, you've got to write a book. That's mandatory.
Well, so I sort of smelled the opportunity there. And so it was about 5 years ago, I start working on this. And then, as you know, having published a wonderful book, at least in my experience, boy, it was just difficult. I had to find an agent. And then the agent and I had to find a publisher. And I'm just thrilled that it happened eventually. And then once I got the publisher, and they have just been so helpful. I can't imagine doing it on my own now that I've had all the help. But it really was just built on these ideas, like I mentioned a moment ago, trying to help people in very easy to read language. You know, my somewhat silly and occasionally irreverent sense of humor is manifest throughout the book. But it's just an introduction to what is this villain that no one's talking about? Who is it? Where is it coming from? Why does it matter? In other words, what are all the diseases that are coming from it? And then finally, it sort of reads like a horror story, but it ends with a really happy ending, which is you can change this like tomorrow. You can start making significant changes in insulin sensitivity. And that is entirely lifestyle and it almost totally based on diet. Exercise yet matters. Sleep matters and stress matters. And I go through all that. You can be doing all those perfectly, and if your diet is still junk, it's not going to make a difference. Diet is the single most powerful variable, and to make it diplomatic, even still, Ken, I promise I'm not normally diplomatic. I actually like being a little abrasive, but where I think there's so much common ground from the vegans on one end, and which I am academically opposed to. I just have to say that that is not sustainable for humans long term in any situation. So we have the vegans on one end and we have the carnivore on the other. What I believe can be common and ought to be among them is that they're both avoiding processed foods. 100%. If a person is simply avoiding processed foods, even if they're vegan, I can defend a vegan diet only to that degree and say, if it's a whole food vegan diet, awesome. You're going to be addressing your insulin resistance. Of course, you're going to die from different types of anemia and other problems, but at least your insulin sensitivity is going to be better.
Yeah. And that's what I tell people all the time is that I would much prefer you eat a vegan diet than the standard American diet. I 100% agree with that. That's going to get you some way down the road. And vegans pull at my heartstrings because I know that they're thinking, right? They're looking, they're trying, they're not just blindly stuffing whatever Kellogg's and Kraft's tells them to stuff in their face hole. They're actually trying to think about their diet. And I think that's an excellent first step. And I think sometimes carnivores, you know, when you're eating a carnivore diet, your testosterone goes up to the point where you have maybe less patience with people and you maybe are a little more mouthy than you should be sometimes. And I think a lot of carnivores will try to put vegans in their place. And I don't think that's the way we should be doing it and the way we should be looking at it. These guys are looking, they're searching just like we are, but they've taken a temporary, I would consider it a wrong detour. They went the wrong direction, but we can actually help turn them around and say, yeah, I know you're looking and you're doing better than you were, but let's look at a higher fat diet and more protein because humans are by definition a low carbohydrate mammal. And I don't think that's really up for debate when you look at the paleoanthropological evidence. Yep. We've been eating fatty meat for eons. Depending on your religious, you know, proclivity, we've been eating fatty meat for as long as we've been on this planet. There's no way you can argue that from any kind of a scientific standpoint. And so to say now that somehow meat is bad for you magically and that you should eat nothing but plant-based foods, it's silly. But the people who are practicing it are not silly. They're just temporarily deluded. And I think it's the job of people who are eating keto and carnivore to go help them and say, hey, I know what you're looking for. I was looking for it too. I found it. Are you sure you found it? And I think that'd be a much more productive way to help turn more people back towards the proper human diet than making fun of them and making fun of their bicep size and that kind of foolishness.
Yeah, well said. Yeah, that is a great perspective. And to add to that idea, I'm not, full disclosure, I'm not an anthropologist, so I don't study human evolution or human history. But whether we look at how we got to be who we are, whether strictly from a biblical sense, which I appreciate, I'm a very religious person, or purely from an evolutionary sense, we know that Adam and Eve were eating meat the moment they were out of the Garden of Eden, and we know the best available evidence of human evolution is that not only have we been eating meat for millennia, but or millions of years, I don't really know, but indeed the argument is made that it's eating meat that turned us into who we are. This idea of eating meat in all its nutrient density allowed our brains to get big and allowed our intestines to shrink. And those are two of the biggest differences between us and other primates with regards to organ function. We have these energy hungry brains and very short intestines. They didn't need to be long because we were getting so much nutrient density from the meat that we were eating. So the meat actually potentially, as the theory goes, turned us into who we are.
Yes, absolutely. And I am also not a paleoanthropologist, but as you can see from my library back here, I've been digging deep into the paleoanthropological research for some time now. I find it fascinating that we can do carbon isotope and nitrogen isotope and strontium isotope analysis, and we can tell from a bone, from a tooth, what that person, the majority of what they ate. We can tell, was it a meat heavy diet? Was it seafood heavy? Was it red meat heavy? Did they eat C3 or C4 plants? Was it more wheat and millet, or was it more of the other grains? We can tell all of that stuff. This is not up for debate. This is kind of settled science in paleoanthropology. Yeah, yeah. And so I really feel like there's a lot of gurus in the health and nutrition field kind of don't want to talk about that because that becomes very uncomfortable very quickly for them and what they're trying to sell. Somebody asked, what is the name of your book, Doc, and is it available for pre-order?
Well, thank you. Yeah, thanks for letting me mention it. Yeah, it's Why We Get Sick, and it's available for pre-order anywhere books are sold. Why? Amazon, Barnes & Noble.
I love it. Dr. Ben Bikman, Why We Get Sick. Doc, let's say I've got a patient comes into the office. They're 80 pounds overweight. Their C-peptide is double the normal level. Their fasting insulin is 40. How long is it going to take this person who's just eating? Well, they're actually not even eating the standard American diet, Dr. Bikman. They're eating the American Diabetes Association recommended diet. They're making their whole wheat pancakes off their website.
Yeah.
They're eating the toaster strudel that's on the recipe on their website. They're eating the granola that's full of oats and full of, they're eating that from the American Diabetes Association website. But the problem is that their A1C keeps getting worse and worse, and they keep getting fatter and fatter. Their previous doctor had them on two pills and then also started them on injectable insulin for their type 2 diabetes. This person comes to me and they say, look, I've heard about keto. I want to give it a try. How long is it going to take me to start to lower my insulin? In other words, how many days, how many weeks, how many months? And I know it differs on a patient-by-patient basis. And none of this is medical advice, you guys, so don't get carried away. What's a time frame when they could expect to start seeing their C-peptide, their insulin level, start to go down as they're cutting the carbohydrates?
Yeah, yeah. Oh, what a great question. And I'm thrilled to be able to answer with actual hard data. The only good reason to have a scientist around. That's why we're invited to all the parties, our data. So We did a study last year where we took 11 middle-aged type 2 diabetics, and the average HbA1c, so the average hemoglobin A1c levels, was 8.9%. So these were absolutely diabetic, full-blown type 2 diabetes. And they were given an option. And it was kind of like the paradigm I presented earlier, where the physician who was a collaborator on the study said, this is the your future. You either, here is a, I can have you leave the office with a drug prescription, or, and it probably will never end, or you go through a dietary intervention. And these 11 women in this case study that we published, of course, they elected to do the dietary intervention. And we gave them simple advice, and which was basically, with a little more educational material than this, but it was control carbohydrates, so be smart about it. Keep it around 30 to 50 grams per day. So that is limiting, and that can be a hard transition. Two, prioritize protein. And then third, fill the remaining calories with fat. So fill with fat. And I have an affection for alliteration. So that's control carbohydrates, prioritize protein, fill with fat. And we actually also provided a shake that they could get just to help. And that's, I have it in the background, but we can talk about that later. But it was essentially just the 90 days that came in for weekly checkups just to ensure they were adhering to these simple dietary rules. Now, Ken, appreciate, everyone listening, please appreciate, the advice did not include eat less, exercise more. That was not the advice, which is, of course, the standard advice that we've been giving people suffering from metabolic or cardiometabolic complications for 50 years. We didn't say that. We said, if you're hungry, eat. But if you're not hungry, don't eat. And that can be a difficult transition, when, especially if someone is used to having something in their guts all the time because they eat six times a day, which is also diabetes advice. It's a bit of an uncomfortable transition to realize that hunger comes in two phases. One, is there something in my guts? That passes. Give it a little time, it'll pass. And the second one is the one that can really go for quite a while, which is, am I actually deficient in energy? And if someone's got a lot of fat, they're not going to be deficient in energy. Now, I'm not saying don't eat, but it does mean they can get through that initial phase of hunger. So in 90 days, their HbA1c went from 8.9%, which is full-blown type 2 diabetes, to 5.6, which is not diabetic at all, not on the radar. It was a complete reversal of the disease in just 90 days with weekly checkups, but involving these three pillars of based on the three macronutrients, but also us strongly encouraging them to not starve, don't calorie restrict, don't count your calories. Typically, the calorie restriction will just happen on its own, and that's part of the beauty of a low-carb diet. Just eat when you're hungry, and only when you're hungry.
That sounds familiar to what every other mammal on the planet does. If they're hungry, they eat. And then when they're full, they stop eating. And then they don't eat again until they get hungry. And I feel like that human beings should also mimic that, since we're technically mammals. I think we should do exactly that same thing. And that's one of the most beautiful parts of the ketogenic diet, because I don't remember if you and I've ever sat down to a meal together or not, but I like to eat. And I like to eat a lot, especially if there's fatty red meat involved. And so I don't want to have a small portion size, and I don't want to calorie restrict. I want to eat until I'm comfortably stuffed, and then I want to push away from the table and go do something fun or productive for a bunch of hours before I have to sit down and waste time eating again. And keto, carnivore, it helps me do that. And I think a lot of people, when they're eating a high carbohydrate diet, as you know, Doc, you got to eat every 2 to 3 hours. Or your energy will literally tank, and it's not like that on a keto diet or a carnivore diet.
And to add to that idea, one final idea, the typical advice that people are getting through the American Diabetes Association, not only the meals you mentioned, which are just laughable, but also the frequency of eating. I will say this, at the risk of being accused of being deeply cynical, that is a wonderful way to sell insulin. What a wonderful way to make sure someone's got to be pumping in insulin all the time, whatever you want, and covered with insulin.
Yeah. And it's terrible. I don't suspect a conspiracy, but I do suspect a lot of willful ignorance, because there was a great man who once said that it's hard to understand something if your salary depends on not understanding it or something like that. And I think that's what's going on with the ADA and the average endocrinologist. I don't think they're evil people or mean people. I don't think they're dumb people. I think they're very intelligent and they're very motivated to do a good job. But it's going to be very uncomfortable when they have to admit, yeah, you know, for the last 15, 20, 25 years of my practice, I've been doing this exactly wrong. And I've been making big pharma millions of dollars in the process. But docs listening, healthcare providers out there, listen to me. I promise you, yes, it hurt when I came to that realization. Wow, I've actually been harming my patients and enriching big pharma. Yeah, I did that the first few years of my practice because I was ignorant. I didn't know better, but you can know better. And once you do know better, then you can do better. And I promise you the feeling that you'll get from practicing medicine this new way, it's transformational. It can literally lift the kind of the depressing fog of daily practice. It makes it fun to practice medicine again. So please think about this when you're alone next time and think, am I doing this wrong? Am I giving people advice that's actually literally harming their health?
Yeah, well said. In fact, even the data back it up. In 1984, a scientist, one of the diabetes legends within the realm of science, a scientist, published a paper finding that this Gerald Reaven, anyone can look it up, 1984, Gerald Reaven, R-E-A-V-E-N, he found that if you put a type 2 diabetic on a diet that checks all the boxes, the American Diabetes Association, and the diet has not changed much, the recommendations, they get worse. I mean, it was hard, fast data. Put a diabetic on that high carb diet. You sure it's not whole grains or whatever, they're going to get worse.
Absolutely. Dr. Ben Bikman, author of Why We Get Sick, which is now available for pre-order anywhere that fine books are sold. Thank you so very much for joining me. It's been an honor. I love talking to you. I love getting inside of your head and playing around because it's a fun place to hang out. There's so much more we could talk about, but I know we're both pressed for time, so we're going to end it today. Guys, if you know someone who's a pre-diabetic, a type 1 diabetic, a type 2 diabetic, if they have fatty liver or if they have obesity, or if they're skinny but they've got that little belly pooch, that's also quite dangerous. They need to go back and listen to this entire video from the beginning and then check out some more of Dr. Bikman's videos on YouTube and then buy his book, Why We Get Sick. And I'm not trying to sell Dr. Bikman's book. I'm trying to save your health. That's what I'm trying to do.
Yeah, well said. I appreciate it. Yeah, anyone, please find me, connect with me on social media, Ben Bikman or Benjamin Bikman, PhD, B-I-K-M-A-N. And then I have a new site that I've launched with a couple of my brothers, actually, gethealth.com. And I'll have more and more information there, as well as solutions to the problem.
Excellent.
Ken, thanks again for the time. I appreciate
it. Absolutely, brother. Send me links and I'll put them in the show notes on Facebook and on YouTube in about 30 minutes after we're done. And you got to come back and we got to talk about this more, because there's so much more to unpack about insulin that most people and many doctors just don't get. And so thank you so much for kind of opening the door and let us peek inside the insulin mansion.
Yeah, well, well said. My pleasure, Ken. Thanks, Ben, for the invitation.
Right. See you next time. Thank you so much, guys. I'll see you next time.